From the day that I decided to run for international president, I knew if elected, one of the things that I wanted to do, and that was to produce the history book. Because if we don't tell our history, no one else will tell that history story for us. When we celebrate the King Monument on the Mall in Washington, D.C., everyone talked about the speech, the I Have a Dream speech. And no one remembers or no one says anything about the organizer for that particular event. No one said that A. Philip Randolph, a member of Phi Beta Sigma, was the individual that organized and put that March on Washington together. Without that being done, there would not have been I Have a Dream speech. It would not have occurred. So I think it's important for us to tell our history story and give those Sigma brothers credit for what they did to change lives.
Phi Beta Sigma got so Phi Beta Sigma got so Phi Beta Sigma got so
P-H-I-B-E-A-N-I-G-M-A.
Phi Beta Sigma got so
P-H-I-B-E-A-N-I-G-M-A.
Phi Beta Sigma got so
The date was January 9th, 1914. The place, Howard University, Washington, D.C. Three young Negro male students, Abram Langston Taylor, Leonard Francis Morris, and Charles I. Brown, decided to organize a Greek letter fraternity that truly exemplified the ideas of brotherhood, scholarship, and service. That fraternity, Phi Beta Sigma. With the goal to create an organization that viewed itself as part of the general community as opposed to apart from the general community, the founders deeply believed that each potential member should be judged on its own merits, not their family background, heritage, or influence, without regard to race, nationality, skin tone, or texture of hair.
The organizations at the time of our founding were very exclusive organizations, which made it impossible for many men of talent to become members because they were very picky about many things, complexion, for instance, family history, wealth. And our founders decided that that wasn't important in our society in 1914, just as it's not important today.
They, along with nine other Howard University students, hoped for their fraternity to exist as part of an even greater brotherhood, which would be devoted to the inclusive we rather than the exclusive we. And they became the first charter members. Described as distinguished and poised and truly a hard worker, founder A. Langston Taylor coined the phrase culture for service and service for humanity. The members of the fraternity called founder Taylor Prof., short for professor, because he was always carrying a book, files, or reading.
The principal tenet of our three founders, that common thread that binds them to us now, and this is what I believe they had in mind, and that was an organization of service. You know, it was, and it came out clearly, you know, in the motto that we have is culture for service and service for humanity. And that tells us that the Honorable Founder A. Langston Taylor, that service to the communities is really what he had in mind. And that's what he wanted us to do.
On January 9th, 1914, the permanent organization of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity was established in the Bowen Room of the 12th Street YMCA building in Washington, D.C.
I believe the Founding Fathers really saw a need to establish a brotherhood that was very sincere about working with the common man. They really wanted to put forth a movement that would utilize the skills of regular men from all walks of life to utilize in the communities all across the world that they envisioned at that time.
On April 15th of that same year, the Board of Deans at Howard University officially recognized Phi Beta Sigma, and the following week, the University Reporter, Howard University's student publication, made known the news. On December 28th, 1916, Phi Beta Sigma hosted the fraternity's first conclave in Washington, D.C., at the fraternity house. Lafayette M. Hershaw was the first conclave speaker. Hershaw was one of the founders of the Niagara Movement. 200 members representing three collegiate chapters, Alpha Chapter at Howard, Beta Chapter at Wiley College, Gamma Chapter established at Morgan State College, were in attendance. As a result of that first conclave, an official publication for the fraternity was authorized. Member W.F. Vincent was elected as the first national editor. Phi Beta Sigma responded to a call to arms in 1917 as the United States entered the First World War. The chapters of Sigma were so depleted that only the Alpha chapters showed any signs of activity, and the national office ceased to function. President I.L. Scruggs would ask founder A.L. Taylor to contact the brothers as soon as they reappeared in civilian clothes. Taylor called on the national board to fill the vacancies created by the call to arms, and on May 4th, 1919, wrote letters to the Beta and Delta chapters established at Kansas State College in an attempt to track down the membership. By June 1919, all chapters were reactivated with the exception of Beta Chapter, where the national office experienced great difficulty locating Sigma men.
We're still around, that we didn't find ourselves going out of business during the World Wars, when fraternities and sororities couldn't meet, that we survived the Civil Rights Movement when black folks could not meet in hotels, but we continued to have national conventions and conclaves and churches, and the brothers stayed in people's homes when they traveled to the city for the convention. So I think they'd be pleased that we stayed the course.
I remember going through the line, being hazed, and all that. My brother took care of me. But we had a good time.
In December 1919, Phi Beta Sigma hosted the fraternity's first conclave after World War I. The conference was held in Washington, D.C. It was at this particular conference that founder A. Langston Taylor was given the approval from the General Board to assist in the organization of what would become the sister sorority to Phi Beta Sigma, Zeta Phi Beta Sorority. The 1920s witnessed the birth of the Harlem Renaissance, called the New Negro Movement. Brother Alain Leroy Locke is unofficially credited as the father of the Harlem Renaissance. His philosophy served as a strong motivating force in keeping the energy and passion of the movement at the forefront. In addition to Locke, Sigma brother James Weldon Johnson and future Sigma brother A. Philip Randolph participated in this creative emergence, led by primarily the African-American community based in the neighborhood of Harlem in the city of New York. In the words of Dr. I.L. Scruggs, the bigger and better Negro business idea was first tested in 1924 with an imposing exposition in Philadelphia. This was held in conjunction with the conclave. 25 leading Negro businesses sent statements and over 50 sent exhibits. The whole show took place in the lobby of the YMCA.
And that there was a basic premise on all of them, and they were centered around humanity, service, business development, working together, trying to bring individuals together in different walks of life.
The response was so great that at the 1925 conclave in Richmond, Virginia, the conclave voted unanimously to make bigger and better Negro business the public program of the fraternity, and it has been so ever since. In 1930, the National Program of Education was established to support academic endeavors of graduates and undergraduate students in the fraternity. Programs such as scholarships, lectures, college fairs, mentoring, and tutoring enhanced this program on the local, regional, and national levels. 1934 marked the birth of social action as a national program and the return of founder A. Langston Taylor to the forefront of Sigma. The social action program was implemented to protect the rights and civil liberties of blacks and other minorities from discrimination and other forms of social injustice. Future fraternity brother A. Philip Randolph organized the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters and played a role in the amendments to the Railway Labor Act in 1934, which gave railway porters rights under federal law. This victory and the continuing work of Randolph in the BSCP led to the Pullman Company contract with the union, which included over $2 million in pay increases for employees, a shorter work week, and overtime pay. It also led to the sleeping car porters becoming the first AFL-CIO certified black labor union. The 1940s and the 1950s would show the continued expansion of Phi Beta Sigma. Millions of Americans fought in the military during World War II, including nearly 1 million Negroes. Sigmas also played a significant role in the war effort.
When I was at Howard, then I was drafted and I was sent to Korea. And when I came back, I transferred to Wayne State in Detroit, where I was part of a founding member of the chapter there and served as the first president of the chapter at Wayne State University.
In 1949, the fraternity became an international organization with the chartering of the Beta Epsilon Sigma graduate chapter in Monrovia, Liberia.
Sigma was the first organization to embrace students from the motherland, from Africa, went on to become African presidents. Nkrumah, Ezekwe, Talbot.
The fraternity would extend its international chapters further into Geneva, Switzerland, with the chartering of the Gamma Nu Sigma graduate chapter in 1955.
I met a brother today. He said he's from Korea. I said, what, Korea? All the way from Korea? I said, what? I know we have chapters all Japan, Germany, Gambia, Hamas, all over the place. So we are international.
As the struggle for civil rights of Negroes renewed in the 1950s, Sigma men held positions of leadership amongst the various civil rights groups, organized protests, and proposed the famous March on Washington in 1963.
Pleasure now to present the moral leader of our nation, one who has conducted a massive moral campaign in the southern area of the nation against the citadel of racism, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr.
In Atlanta, A. Philip Randolph helped with the establishment of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference in 1957. In 1959, Randolph becomes a member of Phi Beta Sigma's Iota Sigma chapter in Richmond, Virginia. Brother Randolph and fraternity brother John Lewis would later be involved with the 1963 March on Washington. A. Philip Randolph was the key organizer, and Lewis was the youngest speaker representing the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, otherwise known as SNCC. In 1961, Phi Beta Sigma brother James Forman joined and became the executive secretary of the then newly formed Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Under the leadership of Forman and others, SNCC became an important political player at the height of the civil rights movement. In March 1965, in the fight for voting rights, brothers Hosea Williams and John Lewis, now president of SNCC, led a 54-mile protest march from the city of Selma to the capital of Alabama, Montgomery. During police attacks on the peaceful demonstration, Lewis was beaten, leaving head wounds that are still visible today. Lewis became nationally known for his prominent role in the marches and became a congressman as a Democrat from Georgia. Phi Beta Sigma brother Huey P. Newton helped establish the revolutionary left-wing Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. Originally, The Black Panther Party's goals were the protection of black neighborhoods from police brutality by enforcing constitutional Second Amendment rights.
Police in our community couldn't possibly be there to protect our property because we own no property.
As one of the many advocates of the Black Power Movement, the Black Panthers were considered one of the most significant social, political, and cultural movements in United States history. In 1970, Brother Melvin Evans was elected the first governor of the United States Virgin Islands. In 1979, Phi Beta Sigma celebrated its 65th anniversary in Washington, D.C. In 1983, Sigma Brother Harold Washington became the first African-American mayor of the city of Chicago, Illinois. In 1986, the fraternity opened the Phi Beta Sigma Federal Credit Union, which is open to members of the fraternity, members of the sister sororities Zeta Phi Beta, their families, and their respective regions and chapters. In 1989, the fraternity celebrated its Diamond Jubilee in Washington, D.C. Also in that year, Brother Edison O. Jackson became the president of Medgar Evers College in Brooklyn, New York. In 1995, the fraternity was the only NPHC organization involved with the planning and support of the Million Man March, as Brother Benjamin Chavis Muhammad served as national coordinator of the march.
We want to put 1 million black men in Washington, D.C., representing our wives and our children, to petition the government of the United States on behalf of our people.
We were the only fraternity to support the Million Man March when it was being planned. Of course, everybody takes credit for it after it was successful. But we went a step further. We gave Ben Chavis a place to plan the Million Man March in our headquarters. And I was national president, and we provided office space. It was very interesting to see all of the people of the Nation of Islam that came through our building. FOI was down in the lobby. And people would come out and take pictures of our headquarters because we were the organization that basically gave the life to the planning of the Million Man March.
In 2001, Sigma Brother Rod Page became the first African-American Secretary of Education. At the conclave of 2003 in Memphis, Tennessee, the fraternity added two new projects. Sigma's Waging War Against Cancer, called Project SWAC, and Sigma's Against Teenage Pregnancy, called Project SATAP, as national programs in attempt to combat cancer and teenage pregnancy.
The HIV programs, the programs that we are doing with different community agencies and whatnot, these are the kinds of things that you want to be grateful that you're part of, and lend your expertise to being sure that these types of programs continue. In closing, it was no accident that Bill Clinton selected Phi Beta Sigma opposed to any of the other organizations.
The 2009 conclave in New Orleans saw former President William Jefferson Clinton accept honorary membership into Phi Beta Sigma fraternity. In 2010, Sigma brothers Jerry Rice and Emmett Smith were inducted into the NFL Hall of Fame. In 2012, Congressman Brother John Lewis was awarded the highest medal a civilian can receive, the Medal of Freedom, by President Barack Obama. In 2014, Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated will celebrate its centennial, its 100th anniversary. March on, ye mighty host.